It's a routine day at this dental practice on Canada's west coast. But in a small workshop behind his surgery, Kostadinos has embarked on an extraordinary journey which is taking him to the distant heights of the New York art world, a journey into the mythological past.
I started, I think, around mid-90s. I was leasing a little beach house, and somebody gave me a glue gun, and I had this idea about framing a mirror. That was my kind of a fantasy, and that's how it started, and it kind of went from there. And I got hooked on the process of finding these treasures that are out there and being ignored, you know, waiting to be discovered. It felt like Christmas every time I went out there. And you never knew what you would find. And it was incredible, the kind of treasures that you come across and that catch your eye, and you let your fantasy, you become a six-year-old and you fantasize as to what this can be. And there you can see torsos and heads and wings and dragons and faces, and the eyes are in the right place. So there's a common thread, you know, that kind of joins us, the plant kingdom and the animal kingdom. We come from the same blueprint, I think, because I see all the skeletons of these things are, they also reflect the animal kind of skeleton in a sense. And you see wood that's in different stages of preservation or decay or whatever, and it gives you a glimpse of its history and its origin. These pieces are actually have gone back to the womb. The rivers have taken them into the ocean where it all started, and they've been bounced around and, you know, bathed by the sun and the wind and the ocean and time and seasons changes and all that. And this is, you know, what we see. Thank you.
You're looking at something that comes from the plant kingdom. If we're talking about, say, driftwood, because of many other treasures, it's been, again, molded by rushing rivers and waves and the sun, baked and sea salt and all that stuff. So, and it has a conscience. It has, I think, a spirit or a soul. You know, when you look at a piece, not all pieces. I don't see that in every piece, but the pieces that I choose have to have that for me. Sometimes a piece will be so vivid as to what it is, or it could. And of course, if it's the whole thing, then there's not much you can do to it except maybe enhance it, and you know, so that part could be a very short process in a sense, although it never is. Or it the piece that you start with. Is again, it's such a focus in terms of an art piece that you will augment it and add to it and complete it. So then you have to have the inventory to kind of choose from. It's like auditioning for the part. It's the same kind of energy. So inventory is everything. So I have spent many hours, and part of the process is discovering the treasures, you know. I can be specific sometimes and say, well, I'm looking for a torso, or I'm looking for, you know, this particular shape, or I'm looking for a head. But in general, I think most of the time, I look for something that I will react to, that my core, my soul will react to, and give me a smile.
My world is built around driftwood. My honeymoon, we went where there was driftwood. My birthdays, we go where there's driftwood. The first time he ever took me beachcombing was what a surprise, because I actually brought a notebook and I was just going to sit on the beach and write while he ran off and did this crazy thing he was going to do. But the passion, he was so wonderful. He jumps out of his little boat, ties it up. Before I know it, I'm seeing his body get smaller and smaller and smaller because he's way down the beach. But I will watch him, and he's looking around. All of a sudden, something's caught his eye. And just like a child, he runs to it, drops to his knees, and he's looking around. And pretty soon, what was maybe this big sticking out of the sand became what is now the piece called Athena. It was 8 feet long and deep, and I can't even describe the uncanny way that somehow there is this magical, it's like they're a siren on the beach and they're calling him and he hears them, and he skips through all the other driftwood and there's this piece.
The pieces that I find, the treasures that I find are my models. You know, so, and they're beautiful. And if those pieces talk to you, and some of them do, then it's magic. It's happiness and discovery.
First came driftwood mirrors, then tables and sofas, elaborate and uniquely beautiful functional pieces. But the wood itself seemed to demand even more, and from the furniture, fantastic creatures began to spring into being. Chimera, the monster who terrified the residents of ancient Lycia. Described by Homer as having in the forepart a lion, in the hinder a serpent, and in the middle a goat, breathing forth in terrible manner the force of blazing fire. Cerberus, the fearsome watchdog at the gates of Hades, the Greek underworld, who was charged with keeping the living out and devouring any of the dead who attempted to escape. Pegasus, the winged horse of Greek mythology, who aided the hero Bellerophon in his battle with Chimera.
I was born in Greece, in a beautiful valley, the southernmost valley of mainland Greece. I left the Donkey Age because I grew up in a very kind of remote, very cocoon sort of. Donkeys was a means of our transportation. And, 12 days later we came by boat and we got off in New York and I landed in a new century with all these freeways and the skyscrapers and the noise and it was so exciting. I was 14 years old. My mother wanted me to become a doctor. She didn't say which kind, so I managed to become a dentist.
I'm just going to look now.
Don't bite my finger. I had a very busy general practice and I worked very hard and I was very popular. But I had a triple bypass when I was 36 years old. It seemed kind of tragic at a time, but looking back now, I consider that probably a huge gift for me because it got me off the treadmill and allowed time for me to heal. And I looked for answers for myself and about my health and how I got there. And that's the time that I also realized that I had creative gifts and stuff. So I like to think that, that certainly has contributed to my sculpting skills because as a dentist, that's what you do is, on a very small scale, you sculpt things and you create things. And of course, working with the face and the jaws and stuff, I have an idea of proportion, that in terms of, what looks good and what, where everything is. So that comes to me naturally now. But right now I'm making dentures for the lion in Chimera's head, and we're in the trying stage right now, so. I had another thunderbolt, you might say, from Zeus, and my ankle came to a kind of a seizing end as far as its function goes, and so I have to, for the moment, walk with the crutches. And I was a little frustrated at first because, no, I couldn't play with my big pieces, and I couldn't go beachcombing, and I can, and so... my sweetheart brings me this two blocks of clay, and she set up a table in my gallery, and she's here. Got me a wheelchair. And she says, "Here, go play with this." And it's another dimension for me because I'm having fun with it, and I'm creating all kinds of things with it, and. Again, I'm using now clay to augment and showcase a driftwood piece and create that maybe mythological figure that it's supposed to be. Growing up in the Greek school system, mythology is a big part of society, even though religion is obviously... I grew up with religion as a main the main sort of glue for our culture, but mythology was always around us, you know. When I look at, say, Mount Baker or Mount Rainier, I'm looking at Mount Olympus for me, and this is how I sort of envision it. The West Coast for me is like finding the golden fleece, you know, like you've been an Argonaut, I left the shores of Greece, you know, looking for, you know, the golden fleece, wherever that may be, and I found it here, and I'm smiling as a result of that. Zeus was the head god of the Olympian gods. He epitomized the power of men, you know, the patriarchal kind of society. He was really a lech. He was, he must have personified the lust for women in that era because he was totally preoccupied about, you know, conquering women. Irregardless of who they were, whether goddesses or mortals. And also, he was very, very afraid not to lose his power. He was always watching out for his status as the head guy. Athena is the daughter of Zeus, and she was a goddess of war and wisdom. She tried to negotiate a wise sort of a conclusion to a conflict and using wisdom rather than force. Look at the earth as a goddess. It's no longer sacred. And of course, the state of the environment is a testament to that because I think the earth is dying and global warming, pollution is exactly, it desacralized the image of the goddess. And there was a connection there that we kind of lost, you know, and today. And of course, I think that's part of our problem is that we are disconnected from nature, and it's been a revelation, a reconnection for me with nature to finding these pieces, and then seeing the images they're portrayed. And these pieces have gone from the forest, and then they've been carried through the river god into the ocean, back to the womb, and they've been bounced around for hundreds of years. Some of them maybe longer than that, and this is the result of those wonderful forces, you know. So we're seeing nature and its forces personified in some of these pieces. And of course, if they come back as gods, then it's just another proof that we are part of this thing we call nature. And we need to be a lot kinder and be more respectful and more observant and see, you know, and look at the beauty, because, you know, we kind of trample on these things and we kind of ignore them. But they come from somewhere and they're part of us.
It's early morning, and Kostadinos is arranging his pieces. He has been chosen as the featured artist at a major international conference event. This is the first time that his works will be on view to a large audience, and his first opportunity to see them on display in a large space.
This is my very first sort of exhibition. I don't know how people are going to react to it. They may just sort of take a glance and keep walking, or they may mob it and kind of talk about it, or I don't know. Had a few experiences in my little studio and gallery from friends and patients that a couple of them have cried. I've been asked for autographs a couple of times. He says, even though you're not famous yet, but I want to get your autograph because I know you're going to be famous one day. So, but those are a couple of events that kind of stick with you, and they say, well, maybe there is something here, you know, so. I really don't know how they're actually going to react.
He needn't have worried. Shortly after this event, he was invited to exhibit at a gallery in New York's fashionable Soho district. How does he feel taking his art, so deeply rooted in the natural world of the West Coast, to one of the most sophisticated urban environments in the world?
My hope is that the power again is there, that it will evoke a kind of reconnection to Mother Nature, to Mother Earth. We come from the same sort of womb as the trees did. In fact, they came way before us.
Driftwood is something that the elements have created, and you can see that energy. You can see the soul of the piece. It vibrates, it calls you. And it takes years, sometimes hundreds of years, to create something to that degree of finishing and preservation. So it's like, and I'm sure it's no different. I feel when I discover a piece that's half buried, I'm an archaeologist and I'm discovering, buried treasures and buried, souls, and because you could feel their consciences. You know, it's not hard to feel that. All you have to do is look at them with your heart.